here to see so many people face to face again. Appreciate the invitation, and I'm going to follow up on the concept basically introduced by my fellow speaker here, that adding extra information is really beneficial to our data analysis in our classical search engines that we use. We took that from a little bit of a different point of view. We don't integrate, of course, but we with is the microphone okay? So, but we integrate spectral predictions into that. So what is the problem with most of our DDA search engines that we have at the moment is that we ignore the intensity information that is encoded in our spectra. So if you can consider this an experimental spectrum, you will see there is a conserved pattern. But what we would usually do is we would just predict the number of theoretical fragment lines and match the spectrum against these. And we ignore the fact that we know that some of the fragments are not really present and that there's a certain pattern of the individual fragment ions towards each other, which is completely ignored. So wouldn't it be great if we could just basically compare the experimental spectrum with the spectrum that we actually expect? And if we do that, we could also use measures that are intensity-based and, that, for example, look for a high spectral similarity. So spectral libraries could be a vehicle to use these fragment ion intensities because we can't readily access them. However, the generation of spectral libraries is very laborious and it's also ever incomplete. So there's a study from the Zoo group who spent a considerable amount of time and samples in building a huge human proteome study with a lot of data processing after that. When they compared that to a human spectral library that was generated in 2014, they found there's a considerable non-overlap between the two, which begs then the question, which of these one is the true one? Is your spectral library going to be ever incomplete? And how consistent is your spectral library, especially if it comes from experimental data? So what has been gaining a lot of attention is our algorithms, which can predict how fragment ion intensities look like, and that started off a long time ago by basically putting the mobile proton model into an algorithm, ventured on via classical machine learning approaches, and then in the end, in the later days, went to neural network-based approaches, and there are many more papers by now. This is an incomprehensive list, but a couple of important publications are noted here. And how that usually works is that you take high-quality spectra, you do your data selection, curation, you split your data into your test and training data set, you train your data, you optimize it, and then you go back and do this again in order to basically refine your model until you have what you want. And if you do this a lot of times, you might want to have some kind of automated pipelines to streamline this process. And what that gives you in the end is basically very accurate predictions for any peptide sequence for any organism. So what you're looking at is a mirror plot from a peptide. The experimental one is on top. The prediction is on the bottom. You can see that the predicted ion intensities nicely resemble what you see in the experimental spectrum. And this is definitely a peptide that has not been in the training data set. The training data was acquired in 2018. This is a spike protein of the SARS-CoV-2 virus that we all know a little too much about by now. So we also put down our model, we also created a model of our own and put that out into the world in 2020. We termed the platform INFERYS, and it was a model that was exclusively trained on triptic peptides, HDD only, and was label free. And we now diversified that training data set in the last 2 years to have a new model which can now deal with multiple fragmentation techniques. In a single model, it can do label free TMT Pro multiplexing. And because we diversified the training data set, for example, to include HLA peptides and non-triptic peptides, we see a massive improvement in the reduction in biases across different C and N-terminal amino acids. If you look at a plot of the normalized spectral contrast angle over precursor charge and the older model in orange and the new model in blue, you can see that there's an improvement across the board, the most drastic one being the singly charged peptides, which have by itself often weird fragmentation behaviors just because there's only a single charge in that peptide somewhere. So what can you now do with all the information and, well, the unlimited libraries that you have at your hand? You can start augmenting your classical search engines and adding information that is not yet observable to them. So in these kind of recurring termed approaches, we use a classical search engine to identify candidates. We pass everything to a network, all the PSMs that we identify, and we then calculate intensity-based figures of merit for these scans. And then put an aggregated set of scores towards an SDR estimation algorithm. And there has also been some pioneering work done on this in various fields. And why there's so much enthusiasm about this is because you're basically adding a better separation of your target and decoy populations by incorporating more evidence for your peptides. So on the left-hand side, you will see a plot of a peptide eluting over a certain retention time, and you will notice that the spectral angle here as a representative of the intensity-based scores is much less dependent on the amount of information and the amount of signal that you have in comparison to classical search engine scores like just counting fragment ions or an X score. And why this is because even if you have very low signal, the most abundant peaks in your spectrum will be conserved, and the ratio between these most abundant peaks will also be conserved and can be used as a discriminator between true and false identifications. And if you then hand over all of this to your decoy, target decoy tool, which estimates your error, you can see that in these two distributions, the targets and the decoys can be much nicer separated from each other the moment you add corroborating information that come from the spectra itself. And what we introduce is an advanced version of a rescoring workflow that's implemented in Protein Discoverer. So it's fully embedded, and it's basically a single node that you put into your workflow just after the classical search engine Sequest HT. And exactly what I just told you is happening. All the PSMs without FDR control are passed to a neural network. The neural network calibrates itself to the data to best match the experimental quality, so you don't have to worry about the settings, how you acquire the data. And then all of these predicted spectra get matched, and basically intensity-based scoring generates a set of scores, and we hand that over to Percolator. And all of that is happening on the local PC, because we created a neural network which can run under Windows on your laptop, and is highly optimized for CPU-based processing. It's 3 times faster than the original model, and so you can add this information without spending a significant amount of time on computation, and basically you can add that without adding a lot of computation for a lot of benefit. And I'm going to talk about that benefit using 3 data sets, and I'm going to start off with a HLA class 1 data set. So HLA class 1 analytes are usually very short peptides which bind to MHC receptors. And these are usually not tryptic because some kind of unspecific digestion generates them, meaning that you have a weird charge distribution, they fragment, and they're all very similar, which makes it very hard for classical search engines to discriminate those. And when you look at that, the comparison between Sequest HT and the INFERYS rescoring pipelines that are added after Sequest HT, you can see that you can add a considerable amount of peptides and PSMs to your identifications. And the newer version of INFERYS rescoring also adds the capability to identify singly charged peptides. And when you add such an amount of data, it's always important to find additional corroborating information that all the hits that you have are actually correct. And so we did that and looked at sequence motifs of HLA peptides for peptides coming off a monoallelic cell line. So a cell line only expressing a single receptor, meaning that all the peptides that should be eluted from that receptor should have very similar biophysical chemical properties and also a very similar sequence motif. And when you look at that, you see that all the peptides that are identified in a conventional workflow and then the rescoring workflow, and the ones that are exclusive to rescoring, they follow the very same sequence motif, indicating that all of these hits have been here, but we just didn't have enough information to promote them above the FDR threshold. Because what we're doing just now is we're just taking the Sequest HT results and add corroborating information. Well, in a second use case, I want to talk about that it can also be applied to TMT and TMT Pro labeled samples. Here, the advances that you get in terms of PSM, peptides, and protein groups is much smaller, also just because a TMT labeled sample is something that Sequest HT is really good in dealing with. But I want to highlight something a bit going back to the roots, and something that we all should do is going and looking at spectra again. So using these predictions and the rescoring, you can look at every single PSM that you have identified in your workflow. So on the right-hand side, you see the mirror plot between the experimental spectrum and then prediction. You can see the nice alignment of the spectral intensities, and you can, in this case, even see what kind of MS3, which fragments are used for MS3 quantification, because this was a CID MS2 data set where the quantification was done in MS3. And then the last data set I want to talk about, single cell data, which is usually very sparse. So here we're looking at data from a single motor neuron where the rescoring information adds about 25% of PSMs and 20% of peptides. And the reason for that is quite apparent, that most of the spectra look like the one on the right-hand side. So it's data that is very, very convoluted, it's low intense, there are a lot of additional peaks. In this case, it's ITMS data. And although there is a very nice running ion series in the spectrum, it still wasn't enough to promote it over the FDR threshold. The moment you start adding information about the intensities into this data set, you can see that there is a nice alignment of the intensities of the predicted ions to the experimental ions, and there is really no doubt that this is invalid identification. And after using this, you can actually see that it nicely surpasses our Q-value threshold. And this is not a cherry-picked example. If you click through one of these raw files, most of the scans look like that. So overall, I've shown you three applications. However, all of them have in common that they still use classical search engine as the candidate generator that we use as input for our rescoring. So we have to have identified a single peptide as a candidate for us to actually do some scoring on. And we sat down and we tried to rethink that data analysis and try to abstract it, and basically came up with an algorithm that we term chimeris, which basically uses machine learning based predictions and scoring of intensities throughout without the need for a classical search engine anymore. It's built in a way that it still does a first search, it does recalibrate your models, and then it does a main search with a deconvolution of chimeric spectra. And why this deconvolution of chimeric spectra is an important feature, I'm going to show you in a second. By the way, this is implemented as a cloud-native microservice that basically abstracts all the computation from your local PC. So this deconvolution of chimeric spectra is a point, because it's an issue, because if we loop back to the spectral library I showed you in the very beginning, we plot that as a heat map of the MZ and the retention times, and look somewhere in this range, look for a small bin, or for example, Toole-Thompson window, and approximately a Winnett retention time window, you won't see a lot of places where you wouldn't identify more than one precursor if you would have the sensitivity to do so. Meaning that there are a lot of scans in our DDA data where the hypothesis, like one peptide per spectrum, is just not the reality. So we came up with an algorithm that explains the experimental intensity that we see by, it best explains the experimental intensity in a spectrum with the fewest number of predicted peptide sequences. And in this case, where you see a convoluted MS2 spectrum on the bottom, we can add identifications into that where the ion series nicely matches the experimental spectrum. We cannot add 1, 2, 3, but 4 of these peptides into there. If we look at the retention time of these identifications, they have a very, very similar predicted retention time, and we can find evidence for all of these things in the MS1. So this deconvolution algorithm gives us an opportunity to identify the contributing peptides, so not only how many peptides are in that spectrum, but also what's the proportional contribution of all of these. When we then apply this to complex DDA data, we see very, very, very strong increases in the number of identified spectra, peptides, and proteins. What's important here is that you add a lot of more identification for previously identified peptides, you add a lot of peptides for previously identified proteins, but you also add a lot of things on top. What's also very nice is that this algorithm identifies the complements of various workflows, so basically encapsulating the non-overlap of other approaches that we've seen so far. And where these gains come from, clearly stem from the fact that we believe that most of these spectra contain more than a single peptide precursor. And that pushes the identification rate of a classical one-hour HeLa run where you run your standard from approximately 30 to 50% up to 80% in this case. However, if you identify a lot more PSMs, you have to make sure that what you identify is actually sound. So we spend a considerable amount of time of making sure that our error control is actually up to date. So what you see on the right-hand side is an entrapment analysis where we use an additional database. So in an entrapment case, you add an additional database that you also don't expect to be in your sample. It could be a second organism, or in this case, we shuffled a human database approximately 9 times and stitched it together, searched it both, and what you want to see is that your FDR is on the diagonal. If that's the case, then for every wrong hit you get into your entrapment FDR data, entrapment database, you'll also get a hit into your decoy database, indicating that you have control over your random matching. And in this case, there's also not a difference to be seen between different isolation window sizes, which is very encouraging. So if this puts this to your use, you can come up with a couple of different use cases. There are a couple of different use cases where you can apply such an algorithm. So either you dig very deep into your sample, you look for most PSMs, you have Arabidopsis thaliana data set right now, it has 8 fractions, it's kind of deep, and you add a lot of corroborating PSMs for things that you have already seen. On the other hand, what you can do is you can simply reduce the runtime and increase the throughput. So in case you do not need that very deep proteome, but want to run a lot of proteomes very shallow and quick, in this case, we have different gradient lengths for healers from 8 to 16 minutes, and you can see that chimeric identifies approximately the same number of peptides in the 24-hour minute run from Sequest in 8 minutes. So generally speaking, there are now 2 fully integrated deep learning workflows that are at your fingertips, and Sequest INFERYS Rescoring is the one that interacts with the classical search engine Sequest HT. It's streamlined, implicated to run on your local computer, and it's compatible with most of the major fragmentation techniques. And for immunopeptidomics or single cell experiments where you really need to tease out additional information from the spectra, this is really helpful. On the other hand, for complex samples where you want to dig very deep into, there is this search algorithm chimeris, which is a cloud-native microservice, and it makes use of this intensity-based scoring of the full isolation window and the deconvolution of chimeric spectra. And that gives you a substantially increased PSM, peptide, and protein identification numbers, and also impacts the quantification for sure. And I guess this is definitely a team effort, so I want to thank the whole MSA team. We actually flew a couple of them over. So if you want to talk to us, we'll love to chat. I want to thank our collaborators at Thermo Fisher, especially the PD team. And if there's further information required, we have a booth. And we have also an oral presentation on Thursday looking a bit into the future and another poster today on our ML pipelines. And I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you for the nice presentations. I have a question regarding the modifications. Mm-hmm. So what if we have a modification that is not in your training data?
So the thing is, at the moment, so both INFERYS Rescoring and chimeras are, the capabilities are determined by what the model can do. At the moment, the model is limited to methionine oxidation and carbamidomethylations and cysteines, but it's a request we've obviously have heard a couple of times, and we're working full force on that, and there will be an addition of PTMs in the
Thank
future.
Thank you for presentation. Question. I really liked the motif confirmation that you did to confirm that it's not distorted. And with respect to that question, how many additional PSMs are coming from the tails of highly abundant peptides and therefore dominating your motif analysis?
So most of the additional PSM, so if you have a PSM which gives you a beautiful spectrum and has very high abundant, usually we'd get that with a lot of, without extra evidence. So what we definitely see is that you dig deeper into the lower abundant part of your data set, meaning that is on the lower end of the intensity distribution, because there you only have a couple ions sticking out of the background. But that might just be enough to call identification if you also consider the relative intensities of the fragment ions towards each other and the correlation to that, to the experimental, to the predicted spectrum. Because that will not change no matter how abundant your peptide is. These ratios will be very conserved.
Right, but the question is whether you consider those tails, so the peptides that are, or PSMs that are coming from the tails of abundant peptides, and considering them in motif, because they will have the same scores from your perspective, I think.
Yeah, so I don't have any information on where these additional, like where in the protein these additional identifications came from.
Okay.
Hello, thanks for the presentation. I had a question about the use of the retention times in this model. So I know you said y'all did predicted retention times. Is that used as like a final validation for like the chimeric algorithm, or is it like actually incorporated in the like deconvolution?
So the retention time is in fact incorporated into chimeras in a way that it's both used to filter down the candidate space of things you have to score, but also as an additional score that we use as a measure of confidence afterwards when we hand over the scores to Percolator.
Okay, so like the you would limit the candidates based on like a range of retention time sort of?
Exactly.
And so then score also?
Exactly. So okay. What we do is after the course first search, we do a refinement learning of a neural network model to match the data, and then basically after we have that fit, we can start kicking out candidates and ignore them for scoring if they're off by a certain distance from where would you expect the PSM to be very likely.
Thanks.
All right, thanks for the talk. I have one concern and one clarification question. The concern is the numbers of PSM gains that you report are high, but they're in relation to a search engine that's particularly bad at taking intensity into consideration. So, you know, it would be better to show results compared to more modern search engines that take at least peak ranks into consideration and then see how it improves over that rather than in this case. So that we have a more realistic understanding of what the gains might be. Second question, or the clarification question is, if you know where most of the gains are coming from. You showed a histogram of target and decoy scores, and it seems like one big reason for getting more PSMs is that it's reducing the score of the decoys, that is making them worse, and not necessarily as much on a target matches. Is that a correct understanding, or do you believe there are other factors that are more important than that?
Well, it's certainly a factor that if we believe that the peptide sequence will give you a conserved pattern, then you will definitely punish patterns that don't match the sequence. And if it's a random match, it will have a random sequence. The models will still have learned what the spectrum would have to look like if it were to be that sequence. So you're definitely punishing your decoys in that sense and separating them because you basically push them further apart.
Yeah, thank you.
And yeah, I appreciate your comment on the other search engines. We'll try to implement that in the next talk.
Yeah, thank you for a great talk. So in relation to the chimeras, does the user have the capability to define how many fragment ions need to come from the multiple chimeric species? And if so, what are the numbers that you guys are using for fragment ions?
So there are a couple of different filters which are user configurable, which is the minimum amount of peaks you would want to see in such a spectrum. It's not just a single score that we use, but a multitude of those. So besides the pure number of peaks that we at least want to have to call identification, which is 4, we want to additionally have the most abundant peaks in the prediction. So we want to have a certain number of these, because there's no real merit in matching a small peak that is somewhere next to your Y9 iron while you don't have the respective most abundant ones. So these ones are actually the more aggressive filters than the pure numbers alone is the number of most abundant ones that we match into that.
Okay, but the lower score is 4, and then it'll be scored higher if it's 4 highly abundant?
Basically, yes.
Okay.
I mean, there are a couple of peptides that just have 4 really abundant fragment 9 peaks, and what you usually see in the data is that the cutoff comes from the bottom, so if you have a low abundant signal, you just have the big ones sticking out.
Thank you, Speaker.